you for that very kind introduction. I've known Steve for quite a long time. But one of my proudest moments at the National Endowment for Humanities was to watch Steve get the National Humanities Medal, which is the highest honor that the NEH can bestow in the Oval Office from President George W. Bush. That was a great moment. Steve has given you the background of the war, so I don't have to say anything about that. He did a wonderful job of talking about how the size of event it was. So in the last couple of years, even before I got on the Eisenhower Memorial Commission, I've been thinking about memory and memorialization, specifically about the First World War. I'm thinking about doing a book on this, and so Steve has given me a wonderful opportunity to just talk to you about a couple of the themes that I'm interested in. And this is not going to be a strictly systematic lecture. I'm going to talk and not read. I think you'd rather have me talk about this and get your questions and stand up here and love you. And this is, of course, the centennial of the beginning of the First World War, 1914. Now, in United States, the war is important, but it doesn't play into our memory as it does in the European combatant countries and also those countries in the Commonwealth that fought in the war. I mean, I'm old enough to remember when I was in elementary school on Armistice Day, as they called it then, standing in my classroom for a minute to observe this moment of silence to mark the end of the war. Now that's all I'll go on. I also remember when people wore poppies, which was to commemorate the war. But so we got in late 1917. Our losses were severe, but they weren't anything like the rest of the combatant countries. So we are not really thinking much about the centennial. There have been events. There's a World War I commission that has been formed to try to get an appropriate memorialization somewhere in Washington. But this was very different in Europe and in the Commonwealth countries. And because of the staggering loss. So let me move on from here. I'm going to talk a lot about this. This is the Cenotaph by Edward Lutyens in Whitehall, right where the government agencies are and bureaus in London. It stands right in the middle of the street. And I could use this to sort of illustrate the loss that the Commonwealth and Great Britain had during the First World War. And this is, I think, quite an amazing line. It says, it's been calculated that it would take 3.5 days for the British and Empire dead of the Great War to march past the Cenotaph for breaths. So that gives you some idea of the British casualties alone were nearly a million. On the first day of the Battle of the Somme, 20,000 died. The bloodiest and most costly battle that the British have ever fought, including the Second World War. And one of the things I want to talk about at the beginning was the staggering loss of life, which caused these countries to think about memorialization, or forced them to think about memorialization in a different way. And that was because of the industrialization of war. I mean, war was fought on a scale of ferocity with losses that had never been seen before. In our own Civil War, which I think is the greatest loss of life we had, something like 600,000 casualties. But this was a war that brought not only the dead casualties, but also loss because of the power of these new weapons. There were many soldiers whose remains were never identified, and that's also another factor. And you know the story, I mean, in 1914, 1915, the war was a war of movement. The Germans tried to outflank the Allies, then the war, and then it bogged down into trenches extending from really the channel all the way down to Switzerland. And that war was fought along those lines pretty much for 4 years. And what happened is that in the beginning, this warfare was kind of conventional with charges, advance, and retreat. But because of the advances in warfare, the losses were so great that this could not be sustained. And the war brought the introduction of new weapons and new technology. This is an aerial photograph taken of a French village during the war. And this is the same village after. So we think about air power really in the Second World War. But with the introduction of the airplane, first for coordinating artillery fire, and then for bombardment, and then for scouting, we get the introduction of one of the most lethal weapons in history. And then there was gas. This was also used for the first time. There's a lot of talk about poison gas, but this really started on a mass scale, used by the Germans first in the First World War. There are many kinds of gases, all horrible, chlorine, phosgene, and mustard gas. These were very debilitating weapons. Actually, the fatalities from gas were not as great as one would suspect, but they were debilitating and they were horror-inducing. They left their survivors blinded and maimed, and they could linger once the gas was released. This shows gas being released from German cylinders. Once the gas was released, it was heavier than air. And it sank into the trenches, saturated trees and grass. It had this lethality for long after it was first released. And here are our gas soldiers. This is mustard gas. It blinded people. It caused horrible blistering on their skin. It was a very, very effective weapon, but the Germans weren't the only ones to use it. All the Allies used it. And then there were the use of high explosives. This is a crater created by a mine that was dug under the German lines and then exploded on the first day of the Battle of the Somme. So you get an idea, this was the largest man-made explosion. The sound from this explosion could be heard in London and rattled the windows in London. And there's a description of this written by an aviator who was in a plane hovering above this. They knew this was going to go off. And as he says, the whole earth heaved and flashed. The tremendous and magnificent column rose up in the sky. There was an ear-splitting roar, drowning all the guns, flinging the machine, that is the airplane, sideways in the repercussing air. The earth columns rose higher and higher to almost 4,000 feet. There it hung, or seemed to hang, for a moment in the air like the silhouette of some great cypress tree, then fell away in a winding column of dust and debris. So these were really fearsome weapons that caused huge numbers of damage, especially in the millions. There's not a good estimate, reliable estimate, of the casualties in the First World War, but for the combatants, it's probably something around 10 million. And then there were also a tremendous amount of civilian casualties. So how do you memorialize something like this? As I say, this was a new challenge because there was never killing and loss on this scale before. And this is one of the monuments that I spent a little time on. This is the cenotaph, as I said, in London, in Whitehall. And this became the national memorial to the fallen of Great Britain and the Commonwealth. And what's amazing about it is, I wish you could see it a little better, is that It has no figuration. There are no triumphal soldiers or no processions of soldiers. It's a very stark cenotaph. And a cenotaph is an ancient Greek form that means basically a pillar of support with an empty tomb. There is no tomb here. But what you see is very abstract and modern sculpture in some sense. Devoid of, as I said, many figures. You only have these two wreaths and the inscription to the glorious dead. And this, over the years, became the major site of mourning, not only for Great Britain, but there were copies of it made, and they were sent to many of the combatant, built in many of the combatant countries, in Canada, Australia, New Zealand. They appear. And what was it about that made it this really revolutionary and quite abstract monument such an important and national site to commemorate the loss of the First World War? Well, here's the genius who designed it. His name is Edward Lutyens, L-E-Y-T-E-N-S, and he lived from 1869 to 1944. And he started off as quite a conventional architect who did country houses for the wealthy, often for the aristocracy. And really made his mark before the war when he was responsible for planning New Delhi, the capital of New Delhi. This is the Viceroy's house. And after the war, he did this great Indian memorial arch, which commemorated the Indian soldiers who were lost or served in the First World War. This is really an international war. We think of it as mainly England, France, Germany, and Russia, but there were soldiers involved in this war and combat all around the world. A little bit in China, there were Chinese, in France during the First World War, there was fighting in Gallipoli, in Turkey. So it really wasn't not just confined to Europe. And so he was the designer of it. And the cenotaph was planned for the commemoration of the signing of the Treaty of Versailles in 1919. And the War Cabinet, which included Lord Lloyd George and Winston Churchill, and this man, George Curzon, asked Lutyens to design the memorial. But they didn't ask him to do a permanent memorial, they asked him to do only a temporary memorial for this parade. I'm going to have to come back here in a second. And this is a very bad photograph of the temporary memorial, which was erected in 1990. And it is made really of plaster and wood. And there was a victory parade, an enormous victory parade, that streamed by it. But the memorial, the cenotaph, for some reason, really hit some kind of sentiment. And after the parade, a million people visited it in a couple of days. There had been never anything like this before. And here you can see them. Widows brought flowers from all parts of England, sisters and brothers flocked to this monument, and nobody had ever seen anything like this. It's streams of people, they said millions of people visited this. And then there was decided that because this had somehow hit or evoked such a powerful response, that it would be replicated in stone, Portland stone, which you see here. And then it was commemorated, that is, the permanent mountain was commemorated in 1920 on November 11th. And it was also part of a ceremony which brought the unknown soldier, the body of an unknown soldier had been brought back from France, and passed by the memorial to be buried in Westminster Abbey. If you've been to Westminster Abbey, you know that the tomb of the unknown soldier is a very prominent position in the abbey. And this also helped, I think, to consecrate and to bring another sentiment in a way, because as I said, there were so many soldiers who were lost. I mean, they were either vaporized or blown apart, they were buried and their graves were forgotten. So there was a staggering number of unidentified bodies, and that is why you have the tutoring, the unknown soldier. Because you know, a mother or a brother or a child could figure, well, maybe that is, you know, my father or my uncle. And of course, we have the same thing in the United States with the tomb of the unknown. In Arlington, the French have it as well, the Arc de Triomphe. And many countries have now tombs of the unknown. But so the ceremony was planned by this man, George Curzon. George Curzon was a kind of archetypal English aristocrat. He was viceroy of India. He was in the war cabinet. He held every honor. And he was a tremendous aristocratic snob as well. But when he was planning this ceremony, he was designated as the master of ceremony. So, master of ceremony for the cenotaph. And actually, another amusing photograph. Here is his other great planning event. Now, this is the celebration for the coronation or installation of Edward VII as the Emperor of India. The king didn't show up, but he sent his brother. But this was a tremendous spectacle that lasted for days to really signify the power and majesty of the Raj, of British India. And Curzon supervised this, but when he planned this, he wanted it to be as democratic as possible, and this was also encouraged by the war cabinet. So there was a minimal military parade done, but it was really open to the veterans and relatives of veterans. And this has become Remembrance Day in Great Britain. And the role that the cenotaph plays, now not only commemorating the First World War, but also the Second World War and subsequent wars, is still vital. The Queen comes to this event, the cabinet and the like. And here I show you what it's like. And the actual program of the ceremony is almost completely adhered to today. So this is the living kind of memorial. And I think the reason for this is that this tremendous loss, an enormous loss of life, was impossible to commemorate in the traditional way. And it was with parades of soldiers and triumphal arches and the like. And Lutyens really wanted the simplest kind of armature on which the mourners' relatives could embroider or build on the scaffolding of their own thoughts. severe, stark. It doesn't dictate to you in any way, and it was very roundly criticized for this. There is no religious element to it whatsoever, which is fairly interesting for a national memorial. Somebody asked Lutyens, Lutyens had made a tour of the cemetery in war cemeteries in 1970. And someone said to him, well, he wrote actually, how can you commemorate this tremendous loss of life? How do you memorialize it? I mean, do we have any kind of architecture or tradition that would be capable of doing this? And he said the answer is no. He said the best way to commemorate it would be, and this sounds strange, a solid brass ball of brass. And well, what is that? It means some kind of abstract form, like the cenotaph, onto which the mourners, those who had lost relatives, could project their own feelings, a little bit like a Rorschach blot. And you think about this, and there is a monument which really has all these attributes in Washington. Can anybody think of what that is? Stark, simple, no religion. You look at it, and actually that image is reflected, Vietnam Memorial, which is a big break from all the traditional memorials on the Mall. And that's why it is so successful. Because it is not didactic. You bring to it what your own thoughts, your own memories are. And that, I think, was very much influenced by Lutyens' cenotaph. Now here's some vets at Remembrance Day. Whoops, right here. Now, Lutyens also continued this theme with one of his, I think, greatest works. And you have to realize that what he did is he shifted gears. He went from a kind of domestic house architect, did this plan in Delhi, and then put a tremendous effort into all this memorialization of the war. And this is the Thiệp Phò monument, T-H-I-E-P-V-A-L, finished in quite a bit after the war, 1932. And this monument is just dedicated to the missing, those whose bodies could never be recovered. And inside are the names, I think it's about 70,000. There was no cemetery. Couldn't bury them. You didn't know where they are. You didn't know where they were. And this is a completely original form. It has little elements of the triumphal arch in it, but it's really a kind of abstract composition of arches and blocks. And somehow this also became, I think people would agree, the finest and most memorable memorial. And this is how Lutyens figured that you could actually do this kind of commemoration. And what he did here in the Thiệp Phò Memorial and also in the cenotaph is he changed the way a lot of memorialization was done. And the title of this talk, their name, Liveth Forevermore, was inscribed on another great contribution he did to memorialization. And that is, each British or Commonwealth cemetery, he insisted that there be this stone of remembrance. Like an altar, but not an altar. And that inscription, their name, Liveth Forevermore, comes from Kipling, who was asked to do this by the Commonwealth Graves Commission. And so here you have another solid block of stone with steps leading up to it. Lutyens was fanatic about how these steps would be done and the interval. This is all carefully geometrically planned, just like the cenotaph. And in fact, like the cenotaph, people protested that there was no religious component to this work. And in these cemeteries where this appears, there's also a cross in the Graves Commission insisted, because of this pressure from bishops and clergy, that there be a cross in these cemeteries. So again, this is a little bit, I say, like the fallen, like the cenotaph in its abstraction and its starkness and in its originality. And then there were a wide variety of memorials, some of them close to the ideas of Lutyens, some of them not. And here I show you the Royal Artillery Memorial in London. Some of you may have seen, but kind of unknown genius, Charles Jagger. This is 1925. And this commemorates the Royal Artillery, and the artillery played an enormous part. So what you have is a reproduction of a cannon, and then around the sides, you have depictions of soldiers who served in the Royal Artillery. You have an artillery officer, a driver who drove the horses that carried these cannons, or drew the cannons, shell carrier, and the like. And probably the most startling one, another landmark in the memorialization, the original landmark, is this, I wish you could see it better, is this dead soldier. And when Jagger, who was the sculptor of this Royal Artillery Memorial, wanted to do this, there was a tremendous controversy. And the authorities said, well, this is way too realistic. You can't do this. I mean, this will be really upsetting. Because I hope you can see it, but it's a dead soldier. It's covered with his greatcoat. And the greatcoat that you can see is the collar of the greatcoat is at his feet, and the hem is at his head. So it's not as though he was wearing it, it's been thrown over him. And on his chest, you see his helmet. And then, there was a tremendous fight. Jagger prevailed. He had to pay for a good deal of this with his own money. And inscribed around it is the Royal Brotherhood of Death, a phrase that comes from Henry V. But this was also so unconventional, but in a different way, a much more realistic way than Lutyens. I mean, he used traditional figurative sculpture, but given it a new meaning. He brought more and death. This is not sugar-coated in any way. Here you see the artillery man dead, and with his greatcoat thrown by somebody else over his body. And I want to show you the parallel to this, or maybe the opposite of this. And this is in Berlin, and this is a German monument. This is a monument to a regiment, Queen Augusta's regiment, and the inscription says, "We died that Germany lives. Let us live through you, the living." And what you have is kind of the same thing. A dead soldier covered by some kind of material with his helmet, German helmet and sword. But the difference is you've got a clenched fist here. This is a very different interpretation from the sorrow and grieving realistic aspect. Here you've got this man. This means trouble is coming, definitely. And there was a real difference in the way various countries memorialized the war. All of them quite original, and all of them in response to this tremendous sacrifice. I just want to show you a more conventional one in Great Britain. This is a regiment being mustered. It's called the Response. But this is a very traditional kind of realistic depiction of soldiers getting ready to go off for war. I mean, that comes from a long convention. This is August St. Gaudens, monument to the 54th Massachusetts Regiment. But this is the tradition that that's much more triumphant, much more competitive, much more realistic. Or this monument in Brooklyn, which is kind of mawkish, very Victorian. So I don't want to give you the impression that everything changed after Lutyens. Abstraction and kind of armature-like cenotaph. It didn't. There were many, many strands. In France, there's almost Art Deco trench of the bayonets, which commemorates soldiers who were buried alive in Verdun. And you probably can't see this at all. And another German response is the Hindenburg Memorial, which was built, and it's a monument to Hindenburg, a very important general in the First World War. Massive castle-like fortress with these kind of giant Star Wars-like figures. Very different, very stark, very menacing. In a sub-sense, brutal in its architecture. And this, I think, represents the different ways that people thought about the war and about the role in the war was. The Germans, of course, were defeated, but they, it's a kind of popular sentiment that they were stabbed in the back by the Treaty of Versailles, betrayed by their own politicians. This was also the site of Nazi rituals, and at the end of the Second World War, it was blown up by the Russians. So you not only have different responses to this loss in individual countries, but these responses are very different in nature. And I'm going to end with one of the major Italian war memorial, Reggio Puglia, in the north of Italy. And this also is a unique response. And on each of these steps, behind which are the ashes and bones of Italian combatants in the first wall, it says present here, here. And this is also designed in a fascist style, which is different from the English and different from the German. So to sum up, I think the war brought this tremendous loss. Conventional ideas of representation didn't work. For many people, they felt hollow. They weren't expressive of what had happened. And you had these new ideas about memorialization, mainly led in England by Lutyens, which brought in a kind of tradition of memorialization that you find all the way up through violin. And then you had responses in other countries, which differed. So the war created a new way of thinking about the memorializing the dead, not only did it create a new world, but it created a world that thought about its losses in different ways. Thank you.